Hello, everyone. This week we're going to talk about a personal favorite of mine. We're going to talk about L.L. Zamenhof, a fascinating figure of the late 19th and early 20th centuries, who had an exceptionally positive outlook on the status of world affairs in a very dark era. This week marks the birthday of Ludwig Lazarus Zamenhof, a Polish Jew who lived at the end of the 19th and early 20th centuries, and one of the most famous contributions that he has made to larger world culture is the invention of the world's most popular artificial language known as Esperanto. The idea of Esperanto came to Dr. Zamenhof when he was a very young man in Bialystok, and he was really quite taken with the fact that so many people were fighting along national and ethnic lines, along these divisions that were largely linguistic in nature. They were also religious and historical and so on. But, you know, in this multinational region that featured Poles, Russians, Ukrainians, Jews speaking Yiddish largely, Latvians, Lithuanians, and so on, he felt that language was something that divided people. If only there was some kind of language that would unite people, perhaps that would bring an end to war and institute a new era of world peace. Already as a high school student, he contemplated this, and oh, I forgot to mention, by the way, he came from a long line of linguists himself. His father and his grandfather were both language teachers, and he himself mastered roughly a dozen languages, including English, all the European languages, Hebrew, Yiddish, even Lithuanian. But in 1887, after completing his studies as an ophthalmologist, he published this book, Mezhnarodny Yazyk, or International Language, and he wrote it under the pseudonym Dr. Esperanto, which means Dr. Hopeful. And although he wanted to try and produce this language as the international language, this term Esperanto, or hopeful, became the more better-known term, and that's how the language is referred to today. Here's a chance to see him and hear him in his own words.
Mr. Zamenhof, you are the creator of the world language Esperanto. May I ask some questions about you?
Of course you may. Pleasure.
What was your aim in creating an artificial language?
In the small town where I grew up, there were many languages spoken by different groups. And because of this, there was often bitter quarrels between these groups. So I created a simple, neutral language so that these people could speak one to another directly.
Wow, that was fascinating. And I urge you to go to YouTube and watch the rest of this interview. It's fascinating to hear him speak about it in his own words. Now, it was remarkably well received, and he received so many honors and accolades, including a nomination for the Nobel Prize. But the did not result in any financial reward for him. And in fact, he fell into very dire financial straits. However, during this entire time, he maintained a very close connection with his Jewish heritage, including a recurring fascination with Zionism. Although ultimately, when he was asked to commit himself more fully, he felt that ultimately nationalism of any form was something that separated peoples. And although he felt great affinity for the Zionism of the Jews, which was, of course, the expression of a subordinate nationality, he nevertheless felt that he could not sign in with it. He wanted to represent something larger. To him, that was something he called Hillelism, after Rabbi Hillel of the Mishnah and the Talmud. Hillel, of course, represented a great universalistic idea of kindness to all humans, and he hoped that this new religion would somehow take hold. He later renamed it as Homaranismo, which means a humanness, but that did not find as much favor as his Esperanto language. Nevertheless, Esperanto continued to grow and grow, even in the dark fascist empire of the middle of the 20th century, and Esperanto gained many, many more adherents. The legacy of Zamenhof is that there are approximately 2 million people who speak Esperanto today, including 1,000 native speakers, meaning people who learn this as their very first language. Even more fascinatingly, there is a people in Japan known as the Oomoto people, or it's a faith group based on Shintoism, that believe that Zamenhof is actually some kind of a god himself, and he is worshipped for bringing down to earth the language that is spoken in heaven. They have annual recitations of poetry in Esperanto because they believe that he was a figure who personified the desire for human universalism and world peace. And in fact, Esperanto continues to grow in this spirit today. Wherever you see that green five-pointed star featured in this picture here, you know that Zamenhof's ideas continue to have effect in the world. Well, that's it for This Week in Jewish History. I hope you have a fantastic week, and thank you for listening.